one day soon a song shall rise.
Well, the Hidden Treasures series has been extremely significant for the Seekers because while the public knows about all the main recordings and the live recordings that we've done, there's always been this background of material that's been very, very important for the Seekers. And Decca Records, and in particular Cyrus Mayahomji, decided that that material should be out there for the public, made available. And so I dug into my archives, and Graham Simpson dug into his archives, and we've come up with this material that we hope will be really acceptable to our fans. Quite a few of the songs on this Hidden Treasures Volume 2, I hadn't heard for a little while. When the group broke up in 1968, we all went our separate ways, and a lot of this material was kept in archival form, and so it's only just recently that I've got round to digging out my little collection, and the others have done with theirs as well. So we've been able to remaster those with the help of the wonderful Michael Cristiano, who has sparked up the material. My whole experience of Montreal in 1967 at the Expo was just being in total awe of the work and the effort that had been put into that whole Expo. It was fantastic. We were part of the Australian contingent, working alongside such luminaries as Normie Rowe, Bobby Lim, Dawn Lake, Rolf Harris, boomerang thrower Frank Donnellan, and it was just a wonderful experience because the whole of Montreal had been subsumed by the Expo, and the whole city was absolutely vibrant. So it was a huge experience for us all. Well, the Expo was beamed directly into Australia. So in fact, I think it was the first direct telecast into Australia from the Northern Hemisphere like that. So that meant that our Australian audience was awake at 3 a.m. in the morning. So they were very bleary-eyed, I would imagine, but we had a huge reaction, and all the feedback that we had from that particular appearance was just magnificent. Well, when the Seekers started out, we were really lucky to be involved in a group of musicians in Melbourne that were a bit like the Wrecking Crew in Los Angeles, and we were called on to do backing vocals and play instruments and that sort of thing for various acts, apart from the recordings that we made of our own material. And we worked with people like Adrian, Ussher and Pam Bradley, and Frankie Davidson, for instance, who was on the Volume 1 Hidden Treasures, and they were all so professional. And indeed, we're still in touch with a lot of them now. The Seekers fans, I suppose, were mainly concentrated in the UK and Australia, with New Zealand coming a close third. And the welcome that we always had in New Zealand, and we did several tours there, were just fantastic because the crowd just loved the group, and of course we loved them. My personal reaction to Judith's announcement during that New Zealand tour, when she told us that she decided that she wanted to resume her solo career, I thought, well, fair enough really, because you know, she had given several years of her time to the group, and I thought, well, that's it. And I think the group's reaction varied from person to person, so I'm really only speaking for myself. But at that stage, we kept it to ourselves anyway, so that announcement was very much within the group confines. Hey there, Georgie girl. Yeah, people often wonder why there is this difference between the versions of Georgie Girl that are on the film and the single. Well, the film versions, of course, had to do a specific job. One version was for the opening, and the other version was for the closing titles. So Tom Springfield and Jim Dale went away and rewrote some of the lyrics, and we recorded a special version for the single, which Capitol Records released, and of course then it became a number one. In fact, it was the first number one by an Australian group in America. A new Georgie girl.